Welcome to another episode of Know Thyself. The truth is in knowing and understanding how this knowledge comes to us is very important. That's why we need the Holy Spirit, who is our counselor. And in the character of Jesus, while he walked on the earth, this counselor was in flesh and blood. And that is what we're continuing to discuss. Let's get into today's program. Welcome, Father. Welcome, sister. So, Father, we have a lot of characters. Now, we want to take up this character from Bethsaida, the blind man from Bethsaida. So, if you can give us some insights and also back it up with the psychological aspects, it'll be really helpful.
Okay, Anand, I think I'll read the passage.
Yes.
First. It's reported in the Gospel of Mark, chapter 8, verses 22 to 26.
Okay.
And they came to Bethsaida, and some people brought to him a blind man and begged him to touch him. And he took the blind man by the hand and led him out of the village. And when he had spit on his eyes and laid his hands upon him, he asked him, "Do you see anything?" And he looked up and said, "I see men, but they look like trees walking." Then again, he laid his hands upon his eyes, and he looked intently and was restored, and saw everything clearly. And he sent him away to his home, saying, "Do not even enter the village." So this is the report. As we are focusing on the relation of Jesus with the person, on that particular aspect we concentrate. This is a person who was brought by the disciple, brought by the friends to Jesus in Bethsaida. Bethsaida is in the northern part of Galilee, or the northern side of the Sea of Galilee, Bethsaida, Bethsaida Julia. So Jesus is on the way in the northern part of Israel, and he is on the way, and there he brings to them. They want the blind man to be healed. The strange thing, now Jesus takes the man away from the crowd, and he doesn't say just open the eye, but he spits in the eye and puts his hand on the head of the person. So a visible action. The man doesn't see, but the man can feel the spit in the eye and the hand on the head. And this is away from the crowd. The question is, why? Why did Jesus take him away from the crowd? Maybe he has the opportunity to express himself in whatever. He is blind, but he can speak. Maybe he has his own reason of privacy, and Jesus didn't want to make a public demonstration of his power, but he is really compassionate to this particular person who is blind, and he wants to be alone with him and give him the assuring presence. And then the role of saliva. See, it's a kind of medical sign. So they say it's saliva has a healing power. So especially when you burn your finger, you put your finger in the mouth. And see, when there is something that the dog or the cat, you put the saliva and so rub it. So saliva has a healing touch, that a healing power, that is. So Jesus is using this, but not because he doesn't have the power, but it's a kind of visible sign. And I have heard preachers say he spat in his face. Spitting in the face of a person is insulting that. That's not what Jesus did. And the innocent says spit in the face. So putting saliva on the eye, is not the same as spitting in the face? So Jesus' closeness and putting his hand on. Then the man opens his eyes and sees, but his sight is not clear, blurred. So you would say, had he ever seen trees beforehand? It doesn't have any sense in asking. So I see people, but something strange. So not exactly walking trees, but the sight is restored gradually. There is a growth in the understanding, growth in this particular person. And the second time, he puts the hand on the man and he sees everything clearly. But remember, this is presented in the Gospel of Mark, in the Gospel in a very critical situation. So what comes immediately after this is the confession of Peter. What was preceding was the lack of understanding of the disciples. So the Gospel of Mark has two different, distinct parts. The first part is Jesus' revelation through miracles. that comes to the, this is the last miracle in that. So Jesus revealing himself through miracles, and after every miracle, the disciples' hearts are hardened. They don't understand anything. But now, immediately after this comes the declaration of Peter. Mm. So this particular incident is presented as a symptomatic or symbolic understanding of the disciples, how the disciples gradually come to realize Jesus as the Messiah. This blind man gradually regains the sight or gets the sight and sees everything clearly. And before that, he said a dumb person was brought in and he spoke everything clearly. So the two incidents of the deaf mute and the blind, they are being healed. And this is an indication type of what is happening with the disciples. So in fact, the blind man of Bethsaida remains as a type of the disciples who don't understand first, and then they see everything blurred. First, they did not understood Jesus only as a carpenter. Then they understood him as the great miracle worker, the great king, etc. As the man sees men as walking trees, they did not know clearly. So the clear understanding to the disciples come only later. So this blind man here functions as a model, as a symbol of the gradual growth of the discipleship. But I think there is more to understand. The relation of Jesus to this blind man and this blind man's gradual development, and it's a lot of insight that can draw from the psychology, I think.
I just have the one question. Why did he tell him not to go back to the village?
Well, that is what you call the messianic secret in the Gospel of Mark, again and again. Because Jesus doesn't want to publicize himself. Mm-hmm. Because of the danger of misunderstanding. Even when Peter makes a confession, in the Gospel of Mark, Jesus asks, "Who do you say that I am?" Mm-hmm. "You are the Messiah." And what does that mean? The Messiah is the king, the son of David. That is true, but only partially true. Right. So people were waiting for a political Messiah, a king like David. And Jesus, by performing these miracles, manifested his role as a Messiah, but not as they thought. So he is the Messiah, not the ruling, victorious Messiah, but the suffering servant. Mm. So there are two revelations in the Gospel of Mark. First, Jesus as the Messiah, the son of David, and second, as a suffering servant.
Suffering servant,
yes. So unless and until you realize what kind of Messiah you are, this should not be spoken.
Right.
So if the people come to realize that Jesus is the Messiah, the son of David, immediately they come out for a revolution, and there is the possibility of misunderstanding.
Right.
That's why till then, as I said, until the Son of Man rises from the dead, you shall not speak.
Correct.
So this secret has a limit. Till the death of Jesus, this has not to be revealed. But at the death and resurrection, there is no more possibility of misunderstanding. That is why Mark says, "You shall not tell anybody." That is repeated again and again. After every miracle, don't say it to anybody.
Mm.
And at the end, you say, "Go and proclaim the good news to everybody." So the good news should be proclaimed against the background of the passion, death and resurrection. A Messiah without death, Messiah without passion and death is not the Messiah, the Redeemer.
I think Jesus was, he could have healed him with a word, didn't have to do anything. But he performed it in a way, I think it was also to help the people, those who brought him.
Mm-hmm.
Like the paralytic, the friends brought here. Here are some other people who are concerned about this blind man. And if they brought him there, okay, your rice is restored. Maybe they would have thought, what is this? He would not. So I think he wanted to have some effort on his part to show them that I am doing this healing in the sense. Maybe that's why he brought him out of the village, because all the people are standing there. There is no communication with the friends in the sense. And so when the blind man is led out, I'm sure the people who came with him went with him. And so it's a point of witnessing, doing some effort to restore to give him the sight. And the graduality, I think, has something, it's a psychological sense in the sense. When you first hear something, it may not be clear. But when you meditate on it, you think about it, reflect on it, it becomes gradual clarification in your mind in the sense. And it's the physical sight as well as our inner sight in that sense. When my, the understanding of Jesus, at one time it was like if you spend a lot of time in chapel and praying and that was the only way to come to know, then you slowly come to the realization. Not only that, even when you are relating with the people, when you see the face of the Lord in a person who is suffering, that is also revealing the face of Jesus to me. And the relationship, in the sense, all comes gradually. It doesn't happen suddenly. When you come to know a person and there is a relationship, it takes depth slowly. Mm. I come to understand the other person, not immediately, but in the process, in the sense. And I think Jesus was revealing this fact of this process of seeing more clearly and the possibility of growth in the person. And the first sight may not be the best sight of all when you come. But when you are willing to stay with the person longer, and the clarity of vision will come in that sense. And here, Jesus is touching him. And maybe with the modern science and the medical, will say spittle has a lot of, because the germs and you put it on his eyes. But for Jesus, it was not. Maybe we don't know what was the custom at the time or what they have thought. Like if you have a sore in your eyes, you usually put your saliva in it, it heals. So it has a healing power. And he was willing to use that saliva to clear this man. And so it just shows an intimacy, a relationship in that sense. Okay, I care about you. I want you to be clean. And so I'm not going to do it in a word, but I'm going to take some effort. Really walk with him. This walking with him, and I think led him by hand, it has a symbolic meaning in it. When a person is suffering, when a person cannot see, you walk that person by leading by hand, in the sense, leading him to clarity, leading him to growth, leading him to healing. So he was walking with him, accompanying. Like we saw in the episode of Emmaus, this Jesus is walking with this man. Not only just walking with him, guiding him, holding by hand. This is support. When you hold somebody by hand, it is immediate communication of support. And that's why when you go out, you hold on to the child's hand. The child feels secure in your hands. And that is what Jesus was doing to him. Securely, he was leading him to security. He was leading him to care and to love and understanding in that sense. So with all this, this man comes to know, I am getting something. So his clarity, first he couldn't see everything. Then Jesus puts his hand again. Okay, I am going to lead you to a clearer vision of yourself, of the world, of all that is there. And he touched him that way. And so it shows a lot of care, a lot of love, and also witnessing in the sense, showing to the people that you brought, okay, I'm not going to ignore what your effort you did. Jesus is always, I'm saying, when somebody is helping another person, he's happy about it. He encourages it. When you see that the paralyzed man was dropped down, more than the person was paralyzed, he saw their faith and wanted to heal him in there. So these people who brought him, we don't know if the blind man wanted to ask, but he showed the care in the friends there, and he respected that. And so not only that, he guided him to a clearer vision of their life and a clearer vision of seeing others. So it is a lot of deep meaning in that sense, this guiding in the sense. In counseling, what is that? We have to meet the person where they are.
Okay.
Not where it should be. So then guide them to the place where they want to go.
Right.
And that is what Jesus did. Met them where they are, in his blindness, in their friendship, and in that group there. Led them out of the place. So, of course, they might have talked on the way, even though the gospel is not there.
I think I have to add something more. See, the very purpose of Jesus coming was to give sight.
Right.
So in the Gospel of Luke, in the Nazareth episode, it said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he anointed me. He has sent me to proclaim the good news to the poor, liberty to the oppressed, sight to the blind, and freedom to the oppressed.
Yeah.
And to proclaim the good news, the day of God's favor.
Yeah.
So the very purpose of Jesus coming is presented as giving sight to the blind.
Correct.
And sight to the blind is a very important action Jesus has been doing. There are many instances. And what exactly does it mean, give to the sight to the blind? It's not only the physical sight. It's not only sight, it gives a vision, a vision of life, a vision of what you are. So Jesus takes him out, guides him by the hand, and opens a new world to him. So he first he did not know anything. Then whatever he knows is wrong, distorted, and finally it comes to the true vision. It's not what Jesus is giving. And can we say we do really see the world as it is, the persons as it is? Yesterday we touched the question, do you see this woman? How do you see? Do you see men as trees walking around? Or do you see the persons as they are? Do you have an insight? Or is it only a sight from outside? So what Jesus is giving, this vision of life, an insight into the eternal. And he sees everything clearly. That is what. So when you see a person clearly, then you know who that person is. An image and likeness of God. A brother of yours. A child of God. And in that vision, you have a totally new life. So this man is given a new vision, new light, and he changes. And it's not what Jesus is coming here. It's not what the role of a counselor, to give a true sense of life. So open the inner eye. And I think we can say something about that in the counseling. When you bring a person to the real understanding, with the sharing, but at the same time, guidance. No?
And sometimes, you know, it is the distorted vision that the person is suffering. I remember a child was brought to me, and the mother, and she was so worried because she speaks about her father's death and he is this and that and everything else. And she said, she was anxious. She said, is something wrong with this, my little kid? She speaks like this all. So I said, okay, let me talk to her. I talked to her and I said, why do you speak like just thought like that, that's all. She, there was nothing there, and there was a real attachment to her. She worked always, every day she would come to see me at least for a couple of minutes. And then I told her, I said, do you pray? Yes, I pray to our God, and I also go to the chapel. Okay, then tell Jesus to take away this feeling from me. Because with the children, in the sense, whenever, whatever we tell them, they believe.
Right.
And she went to the chapel and she told Jesus, and later she came back and told me, I don't think about it that way anymore. I told Jesus to take away. And that is the way, in that simplicity, in that innocence, we can tell a child. And she immediately followed it that way. And she believed that if I tell Jesus to take it away, he will take it away. And he told me that. So this is why, and there was nothing wrong with her. Here, this mother was so worried that she was some psychological problem as such.
Right.
And sometimes what they do is that children like this, they'll take them to psychologists. They might give them some medicine and make the things, the situation more complicated. All we need is an understanding. The child may be thinking of something, the imagination they want to work out. And that imagination, we need to say that when you say like this, it will hurt others. We are not used to say, use your imagination that way. And that worked. So when the fear of mental disorder, in that sense, when they come, so see the person where it is and help them to a clearer vision of what it is really. There's no psychological problem, no serious threat in there. Sometimes we make a problem where there is no problem.
I think this is a role of a teacher, guru, guide, a counselor.
Yeah.
Gradually bring the person to clarity. This is a miracle, but the miracle takes time. And I think growth needs time. So as you were speaking about the child coming to the realization, in our personal life also, I think we need time too. We need time to sit quiet and reflect on, and don't think we have come to the real vision.
True.
And another, the growth continues. I remember a book by Carlo Carretto. Carlo Carretto was speaking about the letters from the desert. So once he is sitting in a garden, in a park, and there's the waste box, there's a lot of fetus taken from the hospital. There's a dump there. And then he was worrying about what happens to this child. And then he goes on to speak, The Journey Without End. There is an article, it's called Journey Without End. He comes to the realization, okay, this child, it was in the mother's womb, it died. It is killed. What happens now? Is it over? No, it can grow. So the growth continues, even after the death. This is only one stage. The fetus has, you don't have the chance here to grow, but God gives a chance for it to grow continuously. And so he goes on to reflect on the human life. So every day we learn something more if we are open. And this with the death doesn't end.
Right.
So you grow in knowledge and you grow in love. And the more, and that comes more and more. As this Jesus is leading this person by the hand from the blurred vision to the clear vision, I think we are also being guided. And once you get a vision, I don't think you get the complete vision here. But then they have also the duty to share that vision. And I think that is a counselor is doing. They help the counselee but to grow, to come to a clearer understanding. Don't get the vision and you can tell everything as if you have seen, but let the person become aware. I think you had to say something about how you grow and the lead the person to a country.
Just to add to Carlo Carretto, in another place, he is in the church, in the cathedral there, and every pillar, everywhere, he sees the unborn children. And they are telling him, pray more for my parents. They did it out of ignorance. My mother didn't know. And so the forgiving was there and the clearer vision. And you see, in the counseling, in the sense you are going is guide them from wherever they are. You cannot treat three people in the same way. Because all different ones come from different positions. It's like when we are in the hospital, in one room you go in, they are happy because a child has been born. In another you go in, they may be sad because a child had died or something, somebody has been diagnosed with the cancer. So wherever it is that we have to go in, we have to realize where they are and to deal with them. And once I walked into a room and this man asked me, or say, chaplain, do you think you are going to convert me? I told him. I said, no, maybe you can convert me. With that, we both laughed, the ice was broken, then we could talk. So, meet each person where they are. And that is what Jesus did.
Right.
He never dealt with two people in the same way.
Yeah. Wonderful.
Everyone was different in his eyes, but he knew where they were.
The uniqueness, yeah.
Yeah. Okay. For some, he just touched the eyes and healed it. For some, he led them by the hand and led to a clearer vision. With another man, he put the spittle in the mud and cleared his eyes. So he was responding to the need of the person or the persons around. And that's what we have to do in our lives. Whomever we meet where they are and see what they need. Open our eyes, be sensitive, be caring. And that is what I think Jesus is asking us to do. Not only in counseling, in our everyday life. Sometimes when we offer help, they may not take it, but at the same time, the very fact we were willing to help, they're happy about it.
So that aspect of the counseling also is very important, to be open and also gradually tell how much they've they can see, you know, and rectifying the clarity that they have.
Yeah.
So that was another wonderful episode to show the transformation in growth. Yes, Jesus is the one who gives us the growth. He is the vine and we are the branches, and we need to be connected with Him. Till we meet in another episode, God bless you. Thank you, Father.
Thank you.